South Philly Representative to CEO, Mr. Randy Sauls, with us this morning. Randy, if you would come on over to the table with us, if you don't mind. Have a seat. We're pleased to have Randy, you had to make some adjustments in the schedule to be able to be with us. But he was able to do that, and he is going to be kind of an overall viewpoint of hospital of where we're in the next few years. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. South Georgia and Langdale Hospice House, basically forms our network, and we treat Texas and 11 dual counties primarily, in addition to our worldwide travels, and we support three counties in North Florida. The commerce and business bring them into our hospital. We're the largest city, so they shop here, play here, work here, and come to the hospital here, see doctors here. That supports our vision statement, as I tell you, the medical center is entirely reaching a pretty destination for healthcare, which will begin to attract more physicians to this community, diversity of physicians. We're next to becoming a full hospital. We have other than services nobody else around us has. So that's fundamentally one of our networks. Second page, we create our separate ground service lines, and many of you know that. Our National Park Center. Premier Magazine, and you saw that, it's one of the premier park centers in the state. Permanent Cancer Center, of course, we've developed a strong spine center here in the community. Strong Women's and Children's Services, and many of you know, we just merged our Women and Children's Services from the Smith and Kansas into the Lane Campus, and that really went on a record short stream, and we had planned that very quickly. And don't manage to take notice and things to way too far in advance. That's one of those things you make a decision to do. Very, very well. We had to do some arrangements inside the hospital to accommodate flow patterns and things, but that has gone very, very well. Surgical services, one of our strongest programs, we do almost 15,000 surgeries a year. And then our imaging center, one of our strong programs, is imaging services. Other services in the day that you might not be aware of, one of the health systems, one of our new care diabetes management, emergency services, healthcare south, and occupational medicine. We're having a strong program for since 2000. We have 358 medical staff members. That's up to medical staff. We do specialty care, and we're organized in service lines. We have an organization as a department. We have over 2,600 employees. We touch about 3,000 Social Security members. Keep all of our part-timers, our full-time equivalents, probably around 2,000 full-time equivalents. 2,600 to 3,000 Social Security members make up those full-time equivalents. 300 volunteers. We do have economic impact. We need to be about $761 million. That's the important thing for the Board of Hospital Association. And then one facility in my surgeons. I talked to Randy Brown, the opportunities. I've got good news and bad news. Good news, I'm coming back, and she got three, got every three. I'm all apart. Dr. Sullivan, the middle gentleman, brings a new service to us that we never had before. That's into vascular surgery. It's a brand new service to us. So it's all that. And that helps create that destination for medical care that needs that goal. He, I talked to him the other day, he probably will play out in the spring.
What is that?
That surgery is when they go into vascular, your cat, like a cat lab, and repair things and press other than your heart. Much difficulties, I already can't, because they have a sleeve and they were getting to the port of space.
But the drummer Rogers had.
Exactly, you know, the service we get. That's exactly what we say, right, we want to make sense. And it's all things that you might have used. Anyway, so, please, that, we got to continue to balance the needs of the community, the audience associated with disease in the community, and attracting resources for patients. Every physician represents a separate specialty, complements one another. So, that's how we live in our ministries. Our ministries have been married for years, it's been not third party in our community. That's what we use to clarify the recruitment positions. I can tell you, recruiting positions are like recruiting athletes. Everybody wants them. So we really have to do the very best. And of course, they've got us by on the floor and we're bringing them because they don't have a place to be. Last week, this person was noticing his current mission. And so we're trying to get him into my appreciate that he's out to rely on us. And I think that is the place for us. They like the college, they like the community. So but they're looking at the places, so we have a meeting and really work hard to track those positions. Every time I bring a position in, or the time I make a comfortable position in, that's the brand new business. They all make it. I'm going to say, I'm going to do it for a little bit. So it's good to be in our community for the community. Well, I talked a little bit about one on page six. You're asking me to speak a little bit about how hospital authority operates. We are an authority, and we operate under the laws of the state of Georgia. The authority is disputed, but it was in 1985 when it started. We've seen a lot of hospitals morph and reconfigure themselves over time and change and move away from the authority model. B.B. Putnam's a perfect example of what can happen when you get too far away from the roots. That position, not our fault, hospital. The questions are the authority and all that, authority to question that real relationship. And so the rest is made in these papers, and that's the situation still not resolved. South of the Medical Center and Hospital Authority of Austin County, it's pretty many years later, it will serve as well as an authority that provides community oversight, provide all protection to the state of Georgia through the law of protection. So far, we've been very pleased with the structure and organization of the authority. So it's just as good as they were. And the success of our organization is two things to the hospital authority. It's important as a building to be very good.
So, Randy, let me just ask, the only authority right now, so what you're telling me as far as functionality, the way the authority works, the way it was so excited into the hospital, all that is working very well. I'm sure there's all those little bits that goes along in any department, but is there anything out there that you might see that you could put your finger on that might say may need improving in that process?
Well, you know, one thing we can look at is that as a hospital authority, you know, they're not able to join a finish or reduce some of the business practices in some of these other hospitals. with physicians, for instance, join finishes and service centers, and they can't own for-profit businesses. And so there are some restrictions to the law that surround hospital authorities. But at the same time, they get the benefit of the tax exemption, and there are some other things that allow them to do. So it is a balance. healthcare, it's tough to figure out how to finance healthcare. A lot of hospitals look to do other kinds of arrangements. And so the authorities are structured so that it's prohibited from doing those arrangements in some way. So these hospitals that get in trouble, they have really no outside their arrangements. But we do those, to answer your question specifically, that's probably a strength of the bar, but it's also, it appears to be a weakness, I'd like to do something. So, but it protects the community from bad deals to do.
Okay.
We do meet the hospital authorities the third Wednesday of every month. We start with an executive session, before noon, 7:30. We have an open session at 9:30. We can do that. Second time, Mr. Greg Powell, and I think that second time. Reappointed to?
To that.
Treasurer or?
No, appointed to the authority.
Those have to be turned out.
It was the city appointed that they reappointed, which is like that.
So the ones that are county are, I know that the district, Dr. Richardson.
Dr. Feldman.
Bill.
Mr. Higgins. Dr. Feldman.
Coward.
Dr. Richardson. Is it Dr. Richardson?
Cities, Sam, Bill.
Greg.
Greg.
City, that's what I call that. And Bill. Bill City.
His cities.
Yeah, we always, the proper party will, when things come up, there's a nominee, we can nominate for you, and we can notify, chair will send a letter to the governing body, and you can help prescribe time to expect it.
Surveys been like any of the three names?
Exactly, in return.
Any questions?
The only thing, so I have, the proper party that we're running for these, within their law, their government law, finance committee, all the places that we're doing against, and we don't come, and we push all the planning committee. But we have exec, we need to only back with our resolution, so we have to act within the committee structure. And the bylaws can be by special committee, the special committee, you know, everywhere. So, I think over the next meeting, I thought you'd be interested in seeing how these committees work. Executive committee, there's no major frequency, it has to be activated by resolution, that's where everyone, that the, you know, it's an emergency matter, but I don't remember ever having that in the recent, but it would be done by resolution. The finance committee, the members are, just on the, you see those, and then the guys and replacement of the staff. And then the major dates of the meeting, 13th, every month, quarter, and the meeting. Often include the patient safety committee, Dr. Feldman, the chair, meets the second Wednesday of every other month in the board room. It also includes two members of the medical staff in that committee, chair of the department of medicine, chair of the department of surgery. Coming back to the meeting. Building grounds committee. The secretary of every month, and there's two members of the medical staff on that committee. The secretary of the medical executive committee, and the immediate past chief, and the chief of staff, serves on that committee. That's where those positions are listed.
Is that Brown?
Brown's staff.
He's past chief.
Personnel committee, also meets at least the second Tuesday every month. To deal with matters in the fourth and personnel matters we plan to do. The joint conference committee is called from county to county. This purpose is to keep the hospital authority and medical staff administration cognizant of pertinent actions taken in contact by one or the other. Directing plans for growth of the medical center, changes in medical center organizational services, and consider issues driving the operation and affairs of the medical center, and it's called town to town. It does have to be at least annual. At least annual. Or any other time it's called. And there are four members of the medical staff serve on that. Four members of the medical staff will be serve on that. Chief of staff, the vice chief, the past chief of staff, and the secretary chair. So for that, And then the bylaws of the special committee, they say it meets from time to time. And some of the trustees manage and monitor and manage their bylaws. So that's the part of this section of bylaws and manage that from time to time. The mayor is it, see? There's two entities in a hospital. There's a hospital authority, and then there's a medical staff. It's called the organized medical staff. And then it works side by side. The hospital authority, it's always supersedes any action of the medical staff, and it cannot be in conflict. So the law of the medical staff and law of the hospital authority that exists, it can't be in conflict. Hospital authority approves and is responsible, legal and organization for all that coming to the hospital. But the medical staff, because basically it's a volunteer medical staff, they're self-governing their own bylaws. Their bylaws can't be in conflict with the hospital authority's bylaws. And so when the medical staff makes a bylaw change in this medical staff bylaws, and it rolls up to the hospital authority's recommendation from the medical staff, and then the hospital authority will approve or disapprove or require a rewrite or whatever for their bylaws. And that's just the course of business that they do that. Can have conflict from the bylaws. The medical staff has its own bylaws. They're self-governing bylaws. If I practice medicine, I'm a physician. I do not practice medicine. The board does not practice medicine. Only physicians practice medicine. And the result of that, they can only govern their bylaws. That's why they have their own bylaws. That's it. They're not employed by us. They're structured to govern themselves.
And from the administrator's standpoint, does the fact that you actually have to have those two bylaws and then, of course, the hospital authority having to approve this other set of bylaws, does that create some conflict? Maybe that's...
It will create conflict from time to time. But not usually, but if there is a conflict, it will probably be a matter that the hospital authority is trying to make sure that the medical staff is recommending bylaw changes consistent with community need, community care. For instance, but the medical staff bylaws could not be changed if we're not taking the ER call anymore.
Right.
They could write a change like that, and then the hospital authority would not approve that.
Okay.
So we have to make sure there's checks and balances there. We have to have somebody to call at 24/7. So their bylaws are done, and their activities as medical staff are set up by the department, Department of Medicine, Department of Surgery, and the Department of SNP. And then you have all the subspecialties under that, neurosurgery, general surgery, orthopedic surgery, all those sections underneath. But it's a very complicated activity.
Yeah.
But that's exactly the reason why the hospital authority has the final say.
Sure. So that's a good sense.
Yeah. And sometimes that would cause conflict. If some physician is passionate about something. But usually their leaders generally will temper that before it gets to the board. Sometimes they may have a joint conference to discuss a matter. So they call a meeting conference with some more help at a regular joint conference. Okay, we have to do that.
Yeah, we have to do that, okay?
And they
call the call then.
The general physicians always want to keep their performance factors to look at the successful care. Sometimes the business models of healthcare will. They're interested in the patient. They really are. That's their primary focus. We do meet together for meetings compliance. I don't even know that. It's something we take place that we want to monitor. But we do have the SDC website, which is our communications now, our digital. We are on the web at SDC.org. And we also land a display case at our main hospital administration hallway with all of our public medicine located. Essentially, they've been located there since, I think, 1985. So, I got a picture of our website, for those of you who never been on the website. It's a very robust website. Most patients now research everything away from the hospital website. They've got to pick their recruitment when they come.
They've got to before they walk in the door.
Yeah, I had a doctor tell me one time he worked at the gone through the whole evaluation. He told the patient the diagnosis, and she pulled out a laptop computer and said, I thought that's what you're going to say. The second page is a copy of this one. This is just like the 10 by the 19. We never bothered with it. There are notices that we can also submit notices of the agendas of a hospital
city has some property out there, it's where the hospital, they give the land. I kind of got the size of my fire truck, but hospital fire will certainly be a share and help me. I do think we need to think about that, but we have a contract, we meet our times pretty much every day, every month, but we have points. But I'm beginning to worry, we talked with many about the people, effectively, and that's not working out kind of like we thought. When we look at that, we look like, and it's gonna have several places, more than the wall place, and that probably won't meet all of our needs. And so we may still do something with the base, but it's like I made it to the base at the time. But it works out with that E4 issue.
If you had another resource for an ambulance in that northern quadrant, would that help fulfill some of the base's needs?
Yeah, most of them are. Right. We don't run on the base right now, we have several contractors, so we don't pick up any of those calls on the base or base housing. Unless we're called, we work for public roads, but we only go on the base, security escort on the base, but we're rarely prepared for base right now. Base ambulance, for instance, a lot of times you see that ambulance from the base and the hospital, where they work those calls. Not a lot of calls out there, mostly standby when they're fine, or they got things sorted, but that's what those ambulances do, they're minutes for the participants of the activities. But that's the one thing that I said we need to think about working up together. That's a good thing. You can buy insurance now. Many qualify for the subsidies.
had to come with purchase of that insurance, and they're there, we don't give purchase policies very affordable. Then when they come to the hospital, then they have access to healthcare and access to, the problem with some plans, though, is they, many of the physicians are not all participating in those plans because they pay for support. So there's no mandate that physicians have to participate in a particular insurance product sponsored by the Affordable Care Act. That's another problem. So you might work with your doctor's office and say, we don't take the Affordable Care Act as well, we should work as a support payer. And so not every physician is something. So I think it's been a good thing, giving people access to insurance to pay for that. Debate the politics of it all, and you mentioned that question, debate why everybody's not coming, but we still have a huge uninsured population in Lemons County today that is not taking advantage of those products. They can't afford them, they don't know how to get them, they're uneducated. It's a federal navigator program. It's supposed to have people sign up. They're not able to navigate.
So you said, Lisa, you still have a lot of people. Why are you sure we still have to pay for them, Lisa, because they haven't got the insurance?
Well, for any number of reasons.
Correct. I'm sorry, you spoke before, and I think this is for Mr. Marshall. What is the ratio between a few years ago and where you're at now with indigent care of the folks that just don't pay?
Indigent care and charity care, the obligation to put a hospital. In the last, say, 7 to 8 years, we've gone from about 3% indigent care to about 13%. 40% Medicare, 20% Medicaid, 13% indigent, and 17% commercial payer. And the commercial payer is what Plano County has and hospital has. Probably they're the ones subsidizing shortfall in Medicare, Medicaid, and that's why the pressure on the private insurance, but the businesses are so bad. They're still subsidizing that shortfall. Medicare pays about 85% of costs, and then explains it this way. I'll let the red cross call at the grocery store. Say the grocer only pays 50 cents for the loaf of bread, and he's selling it. 50% is his cost. Medicare pays 85% of the 50% plus, not the 75% of the cost. So even those programs, there's a gap. Medicaid pays a little bit less. TRICARE is about Medicare, pays less. And so that's the shortfall in the federal programs on the local providers. Because historically, we didn't ever cover that gap. Because the private insurance companies cover the gap. And as the private insurance is beginning to get fewer and fewer, that gap is getting smaller and smaller to cover. And that's why you're seeing stress on hospitals throughout the world. You're seeing hospital closures. Even these large healthcare systems struggle trying to cover that gap. They pay a percentage of costs, not a percentage of charges.
So indigent care is still about the same percent. I mean, the last 4 or 6 years.
And we've said all along, it's going to take several years before the Affordable Care Act will penetrate the uninsured populations. Even with RS communities and all that, they don't really know about all that.
It has a cycle for it.
It's just going to take several years for that to happen. And that's another cause to get every American insured so that they don't have catastrophic health claims in their household.
Unless there's any other questions,
tell us a little bit about Smith Hospital and how the ill and injured determine, do I go to Smith, do I go to South Georgia, is it what services are provided there, what's your plan for that location?
Good question. Smith Hospital is still an acute care hospital, has an emergency room, has an inpatient facility, but it's becoming more of an outpatient type activity. We don't run any of our ambulances or trauma to there. We all have to the medical center. But it's the same fee structure, same everything as the medical center. It's all one plan, so no matter where you go, it's the same product. But Smith Hospital is becoming more of an outpatient type facility. We're in the process now of looking long range at what that's going to be in the future as we begin to reduce cost. Excuse me, back to reduce cost in our healthcare system, because it's sort of described to you. And to make sure that we eliminate any out-migration. So that facility is becoming a more of an outpatient-oriented activity. There are a lot of outpatient surgery going in and out, in and out. And we're going to keep thinking of what other kind of outpatient services we can put out there to make it more of an outpatient facility to reduce the cost of the overhead on it. We've got overhead of the medicine, the laundry, the dietary, all those other kinds of activities we can begin to think about how we manage that facility. And we have to plan those structures, and it takes several years to work through that. But the consolidation of OB was one big move that we've already made. We don't have two OB units. Two of the rooms and two of everything. We've got more than that. That's reduced a lot of cost. But we don't use that facility more as an outpatient facility.
Okay.
We can walk in and walk out. It's a perfect location. No walking deck, no elevator, just walk in and walk out.
And I'm going to be honest with you, there are a lot of people in the Lyons County community that tell you they want to go to Smith. If they got an emergency issue, then they go to South Georgia emergency room. They say something about the time or whatever, but I've been fortunate not to have to go.
I can tell you that.
A lot of people tell you that quick.
Yeah, this flu that's hit us, we've been averaging 194 a day in the main campus right now. Patients in the emergency room a day. And so the emergencies are coming in, but a lot of those patients, we would like them to go somewhere. So they can be treated a lot quicker, a lot faster, Smith, but we still got to get people to self-correct. But everybody still comes to the medical center, and it's just a bottom up. We have 42 rooms in the ER, and it's just a function of, we watch it by time of day. Right now, there's no patients in the emergency room. If I look, I'll probably see maybe 5 or 6. By 5 o'clock tonight, 7 o'clock tonight, it'll be full. That's just the way they come and use the ER. And so that's when we begin to get these backups. And one of the reasons is you still have patients who do not have a local doctor. So we're short of primary care doctors here. So they don't have an attached doctor to go to during the day. But yeah, that's a problem. We're trying to work through that right now. We'd like the patients to go and use our Smith facility. We'd like the very painful. Stay in Berry County, but near county people stay in here as much as they can for those minor emergencies. Obviously, are trying to get together one of those facilities, and we have this to see that you get this sort of education. It's just by a number.
Okay.
This creation eliminated Little Griffin Hospital. Is it Little Griffin Hospital that
had nothing to do? No. That was private. So, yes. It's actually owned by
Dr.
William Griffin. In fact, they told me how that happened when I caught some plain illness today to walk the patients in the entire new general. You guys are playing telling me that's where I made you about 4 or 5 minutes.
Thank you for coming.
I've answered your questions, and it's always
very good. That's where they are.